A warm welcome to everyone this evening. Before we begin, I would like to introduce our speaker for today. We have Cheryl Lee with us all the way from Toronto. She is an experienced trainer and mentor within the realm of business analysis, project management, and change management. She's known for her nonprofit contributions and has co-founded the PMI Toronto chapter business analysis community, the first business analysis community within a PMI chapter. She has also co-authored two books, Effective PM and BA Role Collaboration and PMI Guide to BA. She is a certified professional in PMI-PBA, PMP, and CBAP with an Honours Bachelor of Science degree from University of Toronto. She's president of Toronto-based consulting firm, offering consulting and training services to public and private sector clients across a wide variety of industries. We are very happy and excited to have you with us here, Cheryl. Over to you, Ed.
That was a great job. Thank you for hosting tonight. And thank you all of you for joining us tonight. It's a pleasure for us to put these events together. We learn a lot and we're happy to interact with you. So Cheryl and I have been talking on and off for the last year and a half. And I want to tell you, originally, when I started, when I became the BA, sorry, the VP of events and professional development here at IIBA, I wanted to invite her. I wanted to fly her out from Toronto, but unfortunately we didn't have, you know, the funds. But something amazing happened, which was COVID. And we started becoming virtual. And the first person I thought of was, you know, let's have Cheryl Lee do a virtual event with us. And so that was unexpected, but it turned out really well. And my first conversation was really with her about her and her journey and how she became a BA. Because I believe that none of us, when we're 5 year old, say that I want to be a BA when I grow up. What led you down this path of business analysis?
So like anyone else here, it's probably the same. It was by accident. Like you said, I did not, you know, as a child think, oh, when I grow up one day, I'm going to be a BA. I had no idea what a BA did back then. I actually started off in QA. And so I was a quality assurance analyst and I knew I didn't like that. And I knew I didn't want to do that, but I had no idea what I wanted to be when I grew up. And it was actually through, a friend of a friend who was looking for a business analyst. And specifically, they were looking for somebody with technical skills to work in a business environment. It was at CIBC. And how this started was, I guess they wanted some reports. But, you know, when you contact an IT department to get reports, they were like, yeah, it's going to take you 6 months to do it. So they thought, oh, let's hire somebody with some technical background. We'll get some data dumps and then we'll get someone to query it and pull the reports for us. So that's how I got hired. I have a computer science background. So they thought, let's hire an IT person in a business department. And it was actually pretty funny because being the only IT-ish person in a business environment, my title was a business analyst, but I was literally doing anything and everything to move projects forward and anything IT-ish. And what I mean by that is one day the printer was broken and Cheryl, she's an IT person. Why don't you get her? Can you fix the printer? So things like that. That's kind of how I started my role as a BA, titled a business analyst, but not necessarily doing business analysis work. It was more like Jill of all trades. I mean, a portion of my role was, and, you know, I'm going to date myself. The very first project that I worked on at CIBC, it was something called centralized operating environment. And I don't know if you guys remember back in the day where we had to actually go to your home branch to bank. Otherwise, you'd have to have like your signature card faxed over to your home branch and things like that. See, I told you I'm dating myself now. I know I don't look very old, but I am old. So this project, what we were doing was digitizing everyone's files. And so we had to physically move everyone's records over to a centralized back office, scan it all and put it all into a computer system. And for one day, the boxes from Grand & Toy did not arrive at this branch. And they were like, oh, what are we going to do? And I went, oh, I can get it there. They gave me a stack of banker boxes and a TCC token. That's our subway. And they said, go ahead and deliver these boxes to the Commerce Court branch. Again, I was a BA, right? I didn't realize I wasn't doing real business analysis work until probably my next BA role, where I was titled a BA. And I was finally wearing the BA hat, and that was at American Express. And I found that they were much more standardized in their approach than CIBC was, in that they had, you know, formalized templates for BRDs. They had like a formalized software development lifecycle. Maybe it's also because I worked in an IT department. That could also be a part of it. So the BA role has, I think, roots in IT, although you don't have to have an IT background in order to be a business analyst, if that makes sense. So that's kind of how it started. It was by accident.
So when did you feel like you were a BA? I've landed. Like, I mean, there's obviously the position that they hired you as the BA title, but when did you feel like, oh yeah, I'm a BA and this is a profession and this is a career that I want to, you know, pursue?
Yeah. And, you know, it actually took a while because I still didn't think when I was at Amex and writing requirements and doing all of that, I still didn't understand the career path of a business analyst. And I think many people actually still do not today. I used to think that a career path of a BA was to become a project manager. So business analysis was a stepping stone into project management. And that's what I believed back then. And I think there's a lot of people that are still up against that misconception. And I'm here to tell you that's so not the case. I worked as a business analyst for a while. And like I said, I didn't think it was a career at that point. I crossed over into project management. So it started off with hybrid PMBA roles. And then I moved into PM roles. And I actually became PMP certified before I got any of the BA certifications. And I was doing it for a little bit, but I realized I didn't love it. That was the point I realized business analysis was a career. After I crossed over into project management and realized that, ooh, my, you know, even though I liked project management, I always say my heart belongs to business analysis. So I crossed back and, you know, I had many conversations with other senior BSAs that were working at American Express and business architects and things like that. And, you know, many conversations about, well, what can I do with a career path in business analysis? The really interesting thing is I was probably at American Express, like maybe 15 years ago. And I still keep in touch with those folks that I worked with, my team members there. And very recently, it was probably just a few weeks back, we were chatting again on LinkedIn. And I was like, do you guys remember, like, we had all these conversations about, you know, what do I do as a business analyst? And how is it so weird right now that I'm teaching business analysis courses and inspiring other people to become BAs and stay BAs? And so they were saying that over the years, they've been watching my career and seeing what I've been doing as well.
What's the difference between project managers and BA? Why would you gravitate towards a BA? Like, what is it? What is it that, you know, thrills you? Or
I really love using my analytical skills and being in the weeds of things. So even though, you know, I find that I can do the project management role, where I struggle is I find when you're a project manager, you do have to stay more at a higher level, right? Whereas with business analysis, you're actually in the weeds of things. You're getting up close and personal with your stakeholders and understanding how processes work and things like that. Like I love that. Like I really thrive on that. So that's what I mean when my heart belongs to business analysis. Like it doesn't feel like work to me.
Yeah, I can understand that. I mean, getting close to the business is really, really interesting and really challenging. Mm-hmm. Being that trusted advisor is, it's not easy.
Right.
It's hard work, but once you get there, it's rewarding. You mentioned that you got your PMP, and what was the IIBA or the CBAP journey like? When did you decide to do that?
So I got my PMP and, you know, like I said, I was a project manager, switched back into business analysis at American Express. And then I thought next step for me, I actually thought I'd get into consulting. So I did. I landed a position at IBM and I was consulting there for a bit. And the hiring manager there saw my resume and was thinking, okay, I see that you have a business analysis background. You went into project management, went back into business analysis, and then you're PMP certified. That's really confusing. Like, what's going on over here? And they were going, why are you not CBAP certified? And I went, great question. What the heck is a CBAP? I actually had no idea. So that was what, 2010, I think it was, that I became CBAP certified. So as soon as I walked out of that interview, luckily I was still hired, walked out of that interview and I Googled, what is the CBAP certification? And that's how I started my CBAP journey, literally that day. I went, oh my God, yes, how did I not know about this? This is right up my alley. So, you know, when we talk about turning points in a career, actually, that was probably one of the turning points. So once I became CBAP certified, I had recruiters that were contacting me from through LinkedIn, people I didn't know. So they're searching for people with CBAP certification. And, you know, I talk about this a lot. So I'm sorry if you guys have attended other presentations with me where I mentioned this, but, you know, there aren't as many people that are CBAP certified where there are like over a million that are PMP certified. So, yeah, you know, sure. Somebody right now, if you're here and you're kind of, I'm not sure, I don't have either of the certifications. Do I go for the PMP or do I go for something like the CBAP or even the PMI-PBA, like a BA certification versus a PM certification? If you're going for a PM position, hands down, go for the PMP. But if you're open to BA positions and you want an easier way to stand out among the crowd, go get BA certified. There are only about, you know, 14,000 worldwide that are BA certified. That includes both CBAPs and PMI-PBAs. And like I said, over a million PMPs that are out there. So, you know, there are a lot of recruiters, hiring managers. What do you think they're doing? They're on LinkedIn. They're searching for CBAPs, searching for PMI-PBA. And the pool of folks that have that next to their name, much smaller than PMPs out there. So that's actually where I really excelled in my career. The funny thing is, I remember once I became CBAP certified, like literally within a week, I had recruiters. I had somebody contact me from OLG in Vancouver. So I actually had the opportunity to move to Vancouver when I became certified. And, you know, another turning point then, once I became certified, that's when I actually joined IIBA Toronto. Because again, I had no idea that there were these local chapters. No idea that there was a certification. So after it became certified, you have to maintain your certification and collect the CDUs. So I was looking up, well, how do I collect CDUs? Well, one way is you can attend local chapter events. You can also volunteer at a local chapter. And so I did. I was like, what the heck is a local chapter? So looked up IIBA Toronto, joined IIBA Toronto and looked up volunteer opportunities. And one thing that I thought I'd be awesome at is potentially helping other people become CBAP certified. So I offered to start a CBAP study group. And I believe it was like one of the first CBAP study groups across all IIBA chapters. And that's what I did at IIBA Toronto. And it was really interesting because, so, you know, when I talk about turning points in my career, one is certification, two is volunteering. So Sean mentioned volunteering, stuck the form in there, highly recommend it. So I have 10 years experience in training and development. You know how I got into training? Volunteering. Volunteering. I think we talked about this, right? So Ed and I have a very similar story. How I got into training was IIBA event. It was a social event. I was getting food, finger foods at a table. Someone else was getting finger foods at a table. And it's like, oh, hey, I'm Cheryl. Hey, I'm so-and-so. What do you do here? And I'm like, I'm a volunteer. I just started and I'm, you know, doing the CBAP study group. And they're like, oh, cool. Hey, did you meet so-and-so from Global Knowledge? No, why? And they're like, they're looking for CBAP certified instructors. Maybe you'll be great at that. Oh, cool. That was a Wednesday night. I had a phone interview on Friday, Monday, demo teach. They offered me a contract on the spot, Tuesday, signed contract within 1 week, right? That's what volunteering can do for you. Yeah. It opens like a ton of doors that you just had no idea that were even out there.
Yeah. And food too.
Yes,
What's with you and food?
It is, food is my jam.
So if you ever attended any of Cheryl's presentation, and there's lots on YouTube, there's lots on webinars that she does, it's always there's some aspect of food in there.
I she do
makes, she makes pizza, she makes everything underneath the sun.
I love cooking analogies. So I find, one way or another to incorporate food somewhere, true story, funny thing. So last weekend, long weekend, unrelated to business analysis, but I took out my smoker, that's one of my toys, and I smoked some beef ribs and I was so proud of it. I changed my Slack profile picture to beef ribs. And I work for a client right now and they're looking at it, they're like, I love that your profile picture, it's beef ribs.
The big dinosaur ones?
They are the big dinosaur ones, yeah.
I'm coming to Toronto.
There you go, please. It's the only place you're going to get Texas barbecue in Toronto, in my backyard.
Okay, by the way, the chat is open. If you have a question for Cheryl, if there's something you wanted to ask her about, or if there's a topic that you want us to comment on, go ahead, type something up in the chat, or just open up your unmute yourself and join the conversation, because this is what it's all about. We're trying to be spontaneous. We're trying to have a conversation here.
Yeah, let's talk. Don't worry about the chat. Put up your hand and, or just speak. I'd love to hear from you guys. Yeah, go.
I was wondering, if you got CBAP certified, why did you do the PMI-PBA?
Great question. So the PMI-PBA. So for me, I got the PMI-PBA because I resonate more with as a hybrid PMBA. Like, and on top of that, because I was in training and development, I thought one day I'd want to teach PMI-PBA courses. So let's just say, if you guys already have the CBAP certification, I would say it probably would not be a value add for you guys to also get the PMI-PBA, or if you have the PMI-PBA already, there's really no point in also getting the CBAP. They are both equivalent certifications. My situation was a little unique because of training and development. I wanted to potentially teach those types of boot camps. However, that did open a whole new set of doors for me. For me, I started the first BA community within PMI Toronto. I became PMI PBA certified, I think around the same time I was starting that community. So I thought, hey, if I'm going to chair this community, I should go ahead and get that certification. So I did. I did it during the pilot period. And the interesting thing is, once again, here's the value of volunteering with these local chapters. Through my volunteer experience at PMI Toronto, starting this BA chapter, I caught the attention of PMI Global. And the program manager for business analysis at PMI Global then reached out to me on LinkedIn and invited me to go speak at the global conference in, I think it was Orlando that year. So I did. I spoke at the conference. I met the folks at PMI, and he invited me to be part of this team of global writers, of four writers, to put together the very first PMI Guide to Business Analysis. And, that's how that opportunity came through. It was actually, again, through volunteer opportunities. So that kind of long. So if you have the CBAP, no point getting the PMI-PBA, but I was in a bit of a unique situation over there.
Okay, so I have a follow-on question. Which exam is easier? Because I'm not certified in either, but I'm like debating. Which one do I do?
So here's a different, I'm going to answer it differently. So I don't think that they're both, I think in terms of difficulty level, they're both just as difficult. Like, you're going to get a lot of those scenario-based questions and so forth. Now, my question to you then, Angela, do you resonate more as like a hybrid PMBA? Like, do you have aspirations of, I'm not saying it's the career path to move into project management, but as part of your role, do you see yourself as more of a hybrid PMBA? Do you see yourself more gravitating towards project management, potentially one day going for the PMP? If yes, then I know, I'm sorry, IIBA members, PMI-PBA is usually more popular amongst those folks. However, if you find yourself like, my heart belongs to business analysis and I just love the business analysis work, and you're more of like a peer BA, I'm going to call you guys, then IIBA, the CBAP certifications, that's probably going to be a better fit for you.
Yeah, hi everybody. So I am a recent graduate, so I don't meet the requirements for the CBAP just because they don't have like something like 7,000 hours or so. So I do have plans to get the EC BA certificate in the immediate future. I was wondering, speaking from your experience, Cheryl, do you think that something like the ECBA would also open recruiters' doors to, say, a BA row in the future?
Absolutely. Absolutely. So especially if you're looking for like an entry level BA position. So look at it from this perspective. At PMI Toronto, we used to host a lot of these events called 360 View of a Career in Business Analysis, where we invited recruiters, hiring managers, folks that are currently working as BAs and consultants and trainers. And we asked them questions like, you know, when you're hiring BAs, is certification important? And each and every one of them year over year used to say, yes, certification is extremely important. So they use it as criteria to screen applicants. The company that I'm working for right now, we recently posted a position for PM/BA, and we got 200 applicants. So the honest to God truth is that people are not reading through 200 resumes, right? They're filtering. So how do you think they're filtering? One of the things that they can do is filter based on certifications. So this means that even if you're applying to a posting, like the posting that we posted did not say, you know, BA certification preferred or anything like that, but folks that had the certification, they actually scored higher than those that did not as the first screening. Does that make sense?
Yeah, thank you so much for these insights.
Yeah, no problem. So definitely, like, if you can get a hold of a certification and go for anything like that, like, it's definitely not going to harm you. It can only help you, even in cases where the posting is not asking for a certification.
Cheryl, what do you mean by pure BA? What is a pure BA?
A pure BA is someone who just loves business analysis. And again, like, no intention, like, to, you know, I don't like the PM stuff. I'm not going to touch the PM stuff, and no aspirations to become, you know, PMP certified or anything like that. And the reason why I say that again is because if one day you do intend on getting something like the PMP certification, it does make it harder to recertify, because then you have to, you know, you have two organizations where you have to recertify with IIBA, recertify with PMI as well. So, you know, I find that if you're PMP certified and PMI-PBA certified, you can actually submit all your PDUs all at once, and you can double dip a lot of the PDUs and things like that. So that's kind of the benefit of, you know, if you are more of like a hybrid versus a purist.
I mean, at least looking at the Vancouver market, PMs will earn much more than BAs would do. So in terms of remuneration, so that's, you would consider that as the next level. So, I mean, that my point was that how does one identify what his or her skill sets are and what is more suited for them? And then being within the BA space, how can we make it happen that we kind of get into bigger or high impact projects and roles so that the pay is also much more than what an average BA would earn?
That is a great, great, great question. And I'll admit that's something that I've struggled with as well in my career and very recently as well. You're right. So PMs, they do get paid more. And, you know, I think the world still has this misconception that a career path of a BA is, you know, it's a stepping stone into project management and so forth. But the really interesting thing is, you know, from what I found in my career, and, you know, I don't know if there's project managers in here, and I'm not trying to diss project managers or anything like that, but I do find that the really good PMs are the ones that were once BAs. I don't know if anyone can relate to that.
Yep. That's true.
And
that's where the value is, right? That's the value. You're not like the scheduling, the budgeting. It's logistics. You know, there's no heart in that.
But I agree with you.
The relationship with the stakeholder, when you have business value, that's where it's at.
Yeah. So I find that project managers who maybe did not have the business analysis background, they're more taskmasters. So like you said, it's more managing the administrative stuff. So the reason why that makes them a better PM is, well, how do you identify risk if you don't truly understand the processes, the project and the product and things like that, right? You can't. How do you speak intelligently and connect with your stakeholders without understanding the work that they do? So PMs, again, who I find that do not have that business analysis background, they don't have that mindset. And again, many people I don't think they're realizing that, but I'll tell you, you know, one person at a time, I think I'm hoping to change the people's mindset on this. So the position that I'm in right now, I was hired on as a business analyst, and I was this close to not taking it because I was so offended during the interview. So, you know, they asked for a range. I provided a range, didn't bat an eye. So I'm like, okay, great. It sounds like, you know, we're on board over here. And it wasn't until like the last conversation when it's like, okay, great, here's your offer. And I'm like, whoa, where did this come from? And they were like, well, that's market rate business analysis. And I went, oh, okay. Well, I'm telling you, you're not getting like an average BA. And they're like, well, can you do the project management work? And can you, work with senior level stakeholders and so forth? And I'm like, are you kidding me? Like, why the heck did you come find me if this is what you're going to insult me with? And so they're like, so you can do that stuff? I'm like, heck yeah, I can do that stuff. So he was describing, you know, this project management stuff, because we have to hire a project manager to support you. And I'm like, oh, okay, we'll see how well that goes. And so, you know, this whole thing, how he had to allocate more money to give to the project manager that they were about to hire as well. So through the negotiation, I'm like, well, if this is what you're offering, like, no deal. Like, I know my worth and so forth, and I know what I'm capable of, I know what I can do. I suggest that you don't hire a project manager to manage me, but you hire a project manager to work with me. And so, fine. They thought about it, gave me what I wanted and so forth, brought me on board. And they did. They tried to hire a project manager and so forth. And this project manager did not have a BA background and struggled hard. And after that, you know, I've been at this company for 5 months now, and they're trying to hire they wanted another project manager on the other work stream. But now he goes, no. I want a PMBA like Cheryl. He knows, he's learned his lesson. And he actually said himself, he goes, I see the value of having that business analysis background. So I want either a project manager that was a BA at one point, or somebody that works as a PMBA, because I need somebody to actually understand the work and not just, taskmaster, managing schedule, managing costs and so forth, and managing a spreadsheet was essentially all the other person that they hired was doing.
Cheryl actually wrote a book on this. if you look her up, she's got on Amazon, there's the hybrid BA, project management and business analysis.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of overlap between the two roles in that, you know, we both manage risk, we both manage stakeholders, but we're supposed to look at it from two different perspectives. Now, if you're able to do that as a single person, like as a hybrid PMBA, and see it from the product perspective and see it from the project perspective, like that just makes you, you know, a gazillion times more marketable out there. So especially as a consultant, right? Because you'll never be on the bench. You'll be able to fill in as a PM, fill in as a BA, fill in as a hybrid, whatever you need, I can do.
Okay, Cheryl, I want to move on because we are moving on in time. I want to talk a little bit about your entrepreneurial spirit. Let me try and count. You're an educator. You've got a consulting firm. You have online courses. And you're a writer and author. Tell me what's the drive in terms of your entrepreneurial spirit, and what are the, you know, what is that journey like in terms of having your own business and being the master of your own domain?
You know, it's funny, like when I think back at that, like a lot of that stuff, you know, I'll be honest, it kind of landed in my lap by accident. Like that's how I feel. Like I always say I'm very lucky. Okay. And people say to me, they're like, you're not lucky. I think people see your passion. And a lot of those opportunities, they actually, again, they stemmed from volunteer opportunities. It's just from networking. And you know, I'm gonna take that back. It's not networking, it's building a community of other PMs, MBAs that I'm surrounded with, other amazing folks just like yourselves here at IIBA Vancouver. And whenever these amazing opportunities come up, then that's who they think of. Like I said, the PMI Guide to Business Analysis, like I did not apply for that or anything like that. That wasn't something that I was striving for. Literally they saw the passion that I had for project management and business analysis in this hybrid role. And they thought I'd be a perfect fit for that. And they reached out to me. The training same type of thing. You know, someone else reached out to me co-authoring the other book. It was actually through training as well, where I met another instructor who went, hey, did you want to collaborate on this book? And, you know, that's how that came about. So I don't know, in terms of the drive.
Yeah, so I want to dig a little deeper. Okay. It drops on your lap, but it doesn't magically grow into a book. Right? No. It doesn't automatically grow into a profit creating or opportunity. Like, what is the, you know, how did that come about? I mean, the sweats, the elbow grease in there. Tell me about that part.
It's just passion. Like, I'm telling you, I am the biggest BA nerd out there. My heart really, truly does belong to business analysis, where it does not feel like work. Like, that's what it is. It's a passion project, I think, a lot of these things. And you know, when I go into it, it's kind of like, I think for me also having my foot in so many different doors, it helps reduce the risk from my perspective.
Yeah.
So in that, you know, I take a step back to go write a book, and okay, I'm not really working during that time, but I kind of am, because I'm teaching here and there. Like, I'm not working a full-time job, but I'm still training, like, you know, a few times a week and so forth. So that's, I think, having multiple things on the go has provided me with that opportunity to be able to explore different avenues without taking as much risk, so to speak.
Yeah, you know, some people ask me, hey, you're doing all this stuff, like, where do you find the time? And then I just, just go look at Cheryl Lee, look at what she's doing.
I have no idea. Volunteering is, you know, it's honestly, it's just the, you just have to love doing it. If you don't love doing it, it shows.
Yeah. What do you like the best? I mean, what is at the top for you? Is it the education side? Is it the author side, the consulting?
It depends on, I don't want to say it's not the day. I don't know. I think after you've done it for a while. So for instance, the training piece right now is not something that interests me as much, because I've done it for a while. So I started with the consulting and then the training, which was really, really super interesting. And I still love the training in that, the rewards that you get from training, like you when you get people that come back like years later and go, oh my God, I listened to this presentation and that's what inspired me to get into business analysis, like stuff like that. Like, wow, like you can't get that anywhere else other than, you know, when you're doing the training, doing the presentations like this. So I still love that, but it's exhausting. So after doing it for a while, I wanted to get back into consulting, which is why I accepted this consulting position in December. It was actually a thing, and I had to prove it to myself. You know how a lot of people say those that teach can't do?
Yeah.
So I was teaching for a while and I wanted to prove to myself that I haven't lost my edge. And so I went back to it, and so I guess that's what was driving me there to prove that I can still do it. And, you know, one day I do want to get back to teaching, and in that I'm still teaching actually. And I want to be able to relate to the people that I'm speaking to. Like, I don't want to be this person who says, yeah, I worked on this project 10 years ago and, you know, listen to my advice. It's like, what world are you in? So much changes in 10 years, right?
Yeah, you're like your best competitor is yourself, right?
Yeah.
And you know, if you keep improving yourself, that's never a wrong path to go.
For sure.
Interesting. Tell me about the what is the original idea around the PBA course, the online PBA course? I think that's one of your best products, where it just runs by itself.
It does. And how that came up was, it's kind of a similar concept, like how when I started the IIBA, the CBAP study group, it was just helping other people get certified. And so with the PMI-PBA certification, because it was a fairly new certification, and even with the CBAPs, actually, the reason why I'm doing this is because I find that CBAP certification courses and PMI-PBA certification courses, there are many people out there that are trying to get certified, but the courses keep canceling because there's not enough people that are, you know, signing up for the same time in order to get the courses. So I went, well, that's unfortunate, because how are we going to get more certified BAs out there if people can't get the resources that they need to potentially get certified? And on top of that, like, I see a lot of courses, they actually do cost an arm and a leg, like, you know, who has like a few thousand dollars to go spend on these things. Mm-hmm. So, you know, they came up by just thinking, what can I do to provide these resources to folks where we don't have to have like a minimum number of people registered, where we can also offer it in a cost-effective manner. So that's what I've done. I've created the self-paced course, and I wanted to also create a self-paced course that wasn't just a recording of a live course, which is unfortunately what, you know, many of these self-paced courses are.
Cool. I like that. Okay, we're moving on with time. Tell me a little bit about what, you know, sort of the advice to your young self, you know, someone starting up, starting in the business analysis industry. I was talking to Angelina earlier, just graduated from SFU program, and a lot of our volunteers graduated from the UBC program. What are the skills that are in demand right now, specifically around the BA industry?
So I think if you, well, obviously the key things are, you know, you have to be able to document requirements, but if you can also do it in an agile way. So meaning documenting user stories and you know, understand what what a BA role in an agile environment is, I think that'll make you a lot more marketable. I think many organizations are right now dipping their toe into the agile waters, so to speak, and they're trying to shift to implement functionality in smaller increments at a time. So I think if you are able to pick up some of those skills, that's going to make you so much more marketable.
Yeah. I just saw Holly has a question. Holly, please go ahead.
Hi, Cheryl. Thank you for sharing all your insights. I have one question. How did you get into the speaking, presenting at the conference? I found this pretty intimidating and is really hard for people to get into it. And also how this enhanced your career in terms of speaking to different people. Thank you.
Yes. Okay. Thanks for that. So, I mean, I started off with local chapters. I actually started off with a study group. That was the first thing. I've never done presentations and stuff like that before that, but I started with the CBAP study group. And how I was brave enough to even start with the CBAP study group is, actually, if you think about it, as BAs, you guys are always presenting. Don't you guys realize that? When you're running requirements workshops, like, you're presenting requirements and so forth. You're standing up there in front of your stakeholders and trying to understand what their needs are and so forth. So anytime you run a requirements workshop, you're actually presenting. And that's when I realized it. Actually, I didn't realize it. It was a director at TD Bank at that time when I was working there that made me realize it. So she actually said to me, she goes, you know, do you have experience presenting and things like that? And I went, no. And she goes, well, you're really good at it. And I'm like, really? I never saw it as presenting at that time when I was facilitating these workshops. And that's at that time when I was joining IIBA Toronto, and they were asking, well, what did you want to do? And I thought, I always use volunteering as a safe space to practice new skills that you want to learn. So for me, it was, okay, well, maybe let me try this hand at presenting. So let me try this CBAP study group. So I offered to get that going. And that's how that started. And then after the CBAP study group, it was kind of, you know, I got that teaching gig. And I'll tell you, like, that very first teaching gig, like, I was scared. Scary as heck. And I'll tell you, even now though, so you said you attended my presentation yesterday at PMBA World. I'm here with you guys tonight as well. Before every single presentation, I still get those jitters. And I think I've said to myself, the day that I don't get those jitters tells me it's time to stop. Because that means that I don't care anymore, right? So it means I care. I want you guys to like me. So that's why I get those jitters and those butterflies.
Well, that's fantastic. Thank you for sharing all of this with us. What do you see right now in the industry, you know, with, you know, our current situation with COVID, that employers are looking for when they're hiring BAs?
That's a great question. I think BAs that are generally So one is being flexible. So being able to, I think it's very different actually doing business analysis work in person versus in a virtual environment. So even when you think about when you've gone virtual, like the tools and techniques, so you can't just draw on a white, like, you know, use sticky notes and stuff like that, like we maybe used to do, right? When we were in person, if you guys remember when COVID first started and having to pivot, so to speak, to these online tools. So I would say as a result of COVID, they're saying a lot of organizations, we're never gonna go 100% back full into the office again, right? So I think somebody who's able to manage that, be able to, you know, do things in a virtual environment and still be able to run these types of workshops and also do it in person. I also think that COVID proved that we could move faster than we ever thought that we could, in that projects were being implemented, I think, a lot quicker. Like we were forced to pivot again, so to speak. Like, and this was like industry, across any industry, like think about curbside pickup. Think about all the new little things that we've gotten right now as a result of COVID. Like in any other environment, like that would have taken forever to implement, like even government websites and having to put out like these new benefit plans and so forth, like that required a lot of work and probably for them to move fairly fast to get that out, right? And you know, government agencies, they don't move very fast normally. So I think from that perspective, being fast paced, and I think a lot of people, again, even more so than before, are looking to Agile because they believe that that's a way to get things out quicker. And then being able to, again, facilitate things virtually as well as in person, because a lot of us will have this kind of flexible work style moving forward.
We've had several conversations around, a BA and having those skills that are transferable between industries versus the BA that's specific towards, financial sector. Tell me a little bit about your experience or your thoughts around, how transferable are those skills when it comes to, moving from one industry, from financial to health or something like that, and what your experience has been like.
So I think that the skills are highly transferable. And however, I don't believe that everyone else thinks that way. So that's the challenge. I do find that it is very difficult to change industries. So for myself, I've mainly been in financial industry. So I've been at the big banks. And this role that I have right now, this is the reason why it interested me so much so, is because it was a completely different industry. I'm working for a real estate company. So, I mean, that's totally different than a financial industry, right? So this company that I work for, they purchase single family homes and they rent them out, and they're located, headquartered in Toronto as well as the US. So I work for Tricon Residential is my client. They actually own the Selby in Toronto. So switching industries, I think it's highly transferable. I didn't have an issue using my BA skills in this new environment. I obviously did have to learn the business, but because of my BA skill set, I have that learning ability, if that makes sense. I think that that's an important skill set of a BA regardless. You know, you're having to learn processes, learn new things all the time. So learning a new industry and learning, you know, different things in that way, it's no different to me. I was able to succeed where I am right now. And I think anyone who is a really good BA and has that skill set shall be able to do the exact same thing. But I do caution that I know employers, recruiters, and whatever, they don't always think the same way. So if you have two candidates and one has the industry experience and the other did not, unfortunately, they're probably going to choose the one with the industry experience. So now this is where certification comes into play as well. So you want to be able to tick as many of those boxes as you can. So you can't tick the industry box, but you ticked the certification box. Let's just say this other person is not certified, but has the industry experience. Now you're back on equal ground. Okay. And that's what's going to get you possibly into that door. So that's actually how it got me into this door here. This hiring this person who owns this consulting company that hired me for Tricon, he found me on LinkedIn. And you know how he found me? Searching for certifications. So again, that's how it got me into the door, looking for a different industry. Like I'll tell you, even for me going through recruiters, I really struggled to get out of the financial industry.
Okay, Cheryl, if you were to do things differently last decade and a half, mm-hmm. what would you do?
I may have started my own business, like the training, do my own training thing a lot earlier. I hesitated, and just because I just didn't have the confidence, I guess. And that was a big part of it. I did not have the confidence to do it on my own back then. However, I know other people that have started a lot earlier, and they're so much further ahead right now. So that's probably one of the things that I do regret, not investing in myself earlier. And then you're working for, you know, someone else, and basically things like all of my intellectual property, like my courses that I developed for other organizations, those don't belong to me now. I don't have rights to those. It's owned by the other companies. So that's one thing that I do regret.
Now, you have a unique perspective on like self-investment and training. Tell me a little bit about that and what your personal philosophy is in terms of professional growth and development.
I think because of the consulting background, and actually where that came from, it was actually, you know, when I mentioned my first job at CIBC, I actually started off, my first job at CIBC was a contract, and then I went from contract to perm. And I thought, I really wanted that permanent position because, you know, someone who just graduated, that's what we think that success is, to have a full-time study job. And I thought what came with a steady job and being this permanent employee was that the company invests in your training. And I remember filling out, you know, those assessments and, you know, what your goals are and stuff like that. And I think I said, one day I want to become a PMP certified professional. And the hiring manager like shut it down and was like, you know, well, there's no money for that. I don't know if that's, you know, where your career path will go and things like that. And that really upset me. It really, really, really upset me to the point where it's motivated me to probably to the extreme to do what I've done right now. Let me show you. And so I thought, well, if the company's not going to invest in me, I'm going to invest in me. So if I'm going to invest in me, then I switched back into contract like almost immediately after that happened. I went, okay, well, if you're not going to pay for it, why the heck am I a full-time permanent employee? Like nobody gets to tell me what I can and cannot do. And that's kind of where that came from.
Well, thanks for sharing that. Tell me about what's the best advice you've ever had?
Oh my gosh.
Little cliche, but.
It is. And the best advice is also going to be, it's really just, I don't know, just like being this is probably one piece of advice, is just be kind to anyone and whatever you're doing, just ensure that you're showing your best self. And the reason for that is you just never know when you're ever going to cross paths with that person again and so forth. And you always want to show your best self forward. And on top of that, I mean, people are always going to notice your passion, right? And that has really resonated with me. And it's actually worked out really well for me as well. Because like I said, I think a lot of these things, you know how when I say these things landed in my lap, I think people see the passion, and this is why things land in my lap. It's because I'm always trying to put my best self forward, always having that smile on my face and so forth, and ensuring that I'm kind to whoever I meet.
Yeah, that's a great personal philosophy. Great way to live your life.
Yeah.
You know, how do I look for those opportunities that are non-IT related, and that are more business improvement processes or continuous improvement? And it just seems like there's a whole bunch of, and if you don't have an IT background, it's frustrating, you know.
Great question. Look for ones that are actually titled business analyst rather than like business systems analyst. There usually is a difference. So business consultant, I think, is another like term that they may use and so forth. But definitely like stay away from like the business systems analyst type of things when you're looking for those types of postings. Another thing, I guess if you're a non-ITBA looking for a BA role, don't look for a BA role. What I mean by that is don't look at the title, pay more attention to the roles and responsibilities. So oftentimes they may not necessarily be titled a business analyst. They may be called something else like a process analyst or something like that. So using different keywords to find those particular jobs.
Do you think requirements analysis or requirements elicitation, are those still the key skill sets that people are looking for?
I think so. I mean, definitely. I think communication is big, like that kind of ties into the elicitation and requirements development. Like I said, like if you're able to do it, you know, agile, like for instance, user stories, I think I'm seeing quite often. Another one, modeling. So I think more people are realizing nowadays that pictures may be better than writing heavy text. So if you do have the process modeling, I think I've seen quite often use case diagramming, I'm seeing more often nowadays. So things like that, if you can brush up on modeling skills as well, those could be other things that you can tick off boxes for.
Okay. Okay, last question for me. We'll open it up for everybody and then our time is almost up. What are you looking at right now? I mean, we talked about personal development and training. So I probably about a year ago, last year, we were talking about agile type techniques. What are you looking at now in terms of skilling up, being ready for, I know you don't prepare, you want to say that things drop on your lap, but you know, what are you interested in? What are you reading about? What are you getting involved in for your next gig?
Oh my gosh. Like I said, I'm not even thinking about my next gig right now. I'm like, I'm still at this current gig, at least until the end of this year. So I haven't thought that far ahead. And you know how quickly things change nowadays and stuff, right?
What are you interested in terms of like, you know, the next interesting thing? Might not necessarily be a gig, but this model is, last time I was talking to you, you were talking about state modeling and state models. And is there something that, you know, that's catching your eye right now in terms of a tool or
a technique? So I don't think it's necessarily like a specific tool or anything right now, but one thing that seems to be really big at the we got a new CTO within my organization that's kind of piqued my interest right now, and design thinking. So this design thinking process that she's been trying to implement, that's something that's a little new to me. It's a different way to elicit requirements. It's, you know, they speak about this empathy phase and being able to ask questions of your stakeholders in a certain way where you're not, how could I word this? See, this is something that's brand new. Like it's literally something that I've been doing for the last few weeks now, and that's about it. But it's asking questions in a way where the stakeholder, the user who is performing that role, they don't feel like they're doing anything wrong or anything like that. You just want to empathize with them and understand what their pain points are, understand what their challenges are and so forth. So that's kind of the thing that I've been reading up on lately, because again, I'm not a design thinking expert and now I'm having to do it within my role. And it sounds like it's like the next thing that we're going to be doing for the next few projects.
Cool, yeah. Design thinking is definitely a hot topic right now.
Yeah.
Empathizing with your stakeholders is a huge thing to take a look at.
Yeah, I mean, it's not like a big mind shift in that if you think about conceptually, like business analysis, a lot of it is aligned to it, but it's specifically, I think, what types of questions and how to ask the questions. There's more attention, I think, put up against that I'm kind of struggling with right now.
Okay, I want to say thank you so much, Cheryl. It's always a pleasure talking to you and, you know, sharing your insight with us. and I'm speaking on behalf of the chapter and everybody else here. Really, really appreciate your time and your energy and your passion and your story around where you've been and where you're looking at. So thank you so much for this evening.
Thank you for having me. Thank you to all of you for the wonderful questions. I mean, I hope you've possibly picked something up over here, inspired you to maybe do something different, get into a different industry or whatnot. But, you know, I am on LinkedIn. Feel free to connect with me there if you haven't already. And if a question pops up, I mean, feel free to reach out and I'll do my best to respond.
Okay. Now we have a small gift for you that will come in an email.
Thank you.
That's as a small appreciation for your time here.
Thank you. Thank you. It's so not necessary, guys. I enjoy doing this. I mean, you know, as I said, with volunteering, I mean, I've gotten so much out of being part of these local chapters and local communities that I'm happy, happy, happy to give back.
Thanks, Cheryl, once again, for your insightful information. And we really appreciate the passion you have for BA. It's inspiration for most of us, especially those who are trying to grow in the field of business analysis.